awesome experience in the last 11 years, understanding a lot of things about music's ties to culture and to the community and how ways of life have to do with the ways of playing and that kind of thing. And in that, I would just add in this moment that any kind of music that you're trying to play, if you're trying to get into a style of playing or a type of playing that a person in particular, you want to sound like them, that it is really important to understand the person and the kind of life that goes with it, because there's something there, even if it's not obvious in the moment, as you play and as you spend time with that music, it becomes a part of why you're doing it. And it becomes a really important thing, even if it isn't in the beginning. So I just want to add in and music and how it's enriched things for me, that I'm not just playing the banjo or playing someone's music, but it is a feeling and a type of way of life that you're actually grabbing onto that people have, you know.
Played in the more or less sort of what's come to be known as the round beat clawhammer style. And a few key things about that, like I mentioned, most of the time those old guys played on fretless banjos. Not always though. And what I consider the originator of that style was a fellow by the name of Charlie Lowe. And he was born, if I'm not mistaken, in 1876. And he was sort of an inspiration to all the guys that came along later, such as Tommy Carroll, Fred Cocker, Kyle Creed, Ernest East, all of those guys. They all revered Charlie because he played in a very precise, very technical, clean, and driving sound. Sort of how, like, bluegrass banjo, you know, if done right, drives a band along with the roll. Well, he drove the sound along with how he worked his hand doing the clawhammer. And he liked to play fast, too. There's a handful of recordings of him out there that are a little hard to come by, but you can find them if you look hard enough, and they're really good and give you a good idea of really the sole person who kind of originated round beat banjo style. And one of the key aspects to it is in playing like him and, say, Fred Cockrum and Kyle Creed, they play over the neck, which a lot of folks in the other parts of the country, they all play usually down here over the head or back here next to the bridge. But Charlie played over the neck. Of course, being how revered he was, a lot of folks copied him. And it gives you a different sound, gives you a bassier, thumpier type sound. And the way that they were originally able to do it, now a lot of banjos nowadays have scoops on them, where they scoop this out. I personally don't care for that, but it takes good high action to get the sound right. You see my action quite a bit off the board. So, and that's how those guys did it. They got these cheap mail order banjos and put the heaviest gauge steel strings that they could buy. And of course, what's the first thing that's going to happen is the next going to, like that, crazy action right here. In turn, it gave them the perfect place to play right here and get that sound that they wanted.
All right, Ida Red.
I'll show you this
one. What I've heard is real skinheads, it's hard to keep them in tune.
This one's pretty sexy. It's a removable resonator.
Yeah, they're removable.
That I engineered myself.
Yeah.
And it's a coffee stained goat skin head.
Yeah.
To remove the resonator, I've got a single thumb screw there.
Yeah.
If I come all the way out with it.
Okay.
Spin that a quarter turn.
Yeah, let's see that thing you machined in there to hold it. It's, point with your finger. I could point with my finger, but...
Well, it's just right there.
I see it, yeah.
Just a little channel that I routed in there.
And there's a...
And it's held on.
Yeah, yeah. It's this part here? Or?
It's held on by these nuts.
Oh, those nuts, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
The nuts go in the channel and...
So as you were saying earlier, with and without the resonator,
it sounds quite different.
Different.
Yeah, it gives a lot different character to the banjo.
Yeah.
Prefer it with the resonator off and a little stuffing in it.
Yeah.
But
that's my preference.
I've had some beginners. I've had some pretty darn good musicians that bought my stuff.
Okay, so they do get played. It's not
They get played, yeah. There's a guy, I mean, I haven't really sold to anyone super famous,
but
I've got a guy who's a really, really fine banjo player,
mm-hmm.
Laney House. He's in the North Georgia mountains.
Yeah, okay.
And he plays both...
You're welcome.
It looks good on you too.
Yeah, I really want to start making some. I want to make a roadkill.
Still have the hairs on it and stuff.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just need to wait for the right.
The right animal.
Well, actually, I've never skinned anything, but I want to learn. I'm gonna learn, and then I want to do it.
Yeah.
I really like I want to make a camancha, which is like that violin, that great Arabic violin that's like. Has like fish skin on the thing, so it's like, and it's like really thin, and it's just like, but you play it with it has like a round like neck, and it's like it just sounds like super super like beautiful, and it has like a super like distinct.
You mean real fish skin?
I think so, because it's like super thin, so it makes it very like.
You know, you can buy fish skins. You can buy different skins off the internet. And yeah, and they wouldn't cost you much to get.
I'll let you get back to your.
That's that fiddle tune, Nail the Catfish to the Tree there.
Oh really?
Skin, yeah.
That's cool.
I don't think catfish have scales, right?
They don't have scales. They just got kind of shark skin.
It's super cool that you have like their. I really like fretless instruments. Like,
that's a nice banjo right there. Very unique.
Yeah.
You can play it if you like. If you want to yank that thing out, sit in a chair and play it. You can help yourself.
Cool. I'll give you the chair on.
Oh, that's okay.
Yeah, these are Evo Gold. That's another thing. These frets.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about frets.
They're Evo Gold. It's an alloy. It's a very hard-wearing alloy. I've played this banjo right here for about a year, and there's really no discernible fret wear on this banjo.
Wow.
Yeah, I've noticed that the fine frets are faster, they last longer, and they sound better. And you can get your action more.
This thing, they're hard. I mean, they wear out my files.
So is that a brand name or just a generic?
They're
name?
Made by Jess Carr.
Okay.
And it's EVO, that might be their, I think that's an alloy name, but I call it Evo. I'm not certain if I'm correct in that, but I just pronounce it. It's a capital EVO.
Yeah.
And it's a certain alloy that's quite hard.
Well, that is great. So you actually place the frets.
You're welcome.
Alright.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Have a nice
Alright, you too.
Well, good luck with your roadkills.
Oh, yeah. I'm in the next, 3 years.
Would you kill the animal yourself?
I was just like...
Drive around with a truck and...
Okay. Well,
another thing I do, I do my own inlays, so...
I wanted to, we were talking about that earlier, and that's really cool.
For example, this one's...
Okay, wait a minute, okay.
This is a hunting theme banjo, that's a deer skull.
Deer skull.
It's got a couple, it's got white and black pearl, the horns are black pearl, I've got some deer tracks.
Deer tracks, yeah.
And a black pearl compass. Kind of a compass rose
black
thing there.
Pearl is a kind of mother of pearl.
It's a mother of pearl. It's from a different type of species of shell that's black.
But this is all genuine shell. It's not.
It is, yes,
thing.
Genuine shell.
Yeah.
Just a little star and a dot.
Yeah.
I've been playing it. I've worn off my inlay, my engraving.
That's really cool, though, that you have a different design instead of the same one. Like every two or three frets, you've got something different. So,
well, I built this banjo for myself. I had a hunting themed banjo with a pig head up here and an arrow, and then a bunch of pig tracks and an antler down here.
The wild boar in the woods.
And I sold that banjo. I sold that banjo, and so I wanted another one, and so I built this one for myself.
That is so cool. Get up to speed. Okay, just announce what you're playing here.
What's that? Just announce it?
Yeah, just tell us what you're playing.
Nail that catfish to the tree.
Okay, why don't you play it? Okay. Just tell me who you are and what you do.
My name is Patrick Hefner. I own and operate Pisgah Banjo Company.
Which is where?
And located in Fairview, North Carolina, right outside of Asheville.
Okay.
And we build about 300 banjos a year.
Wow.
We've built close to 1,200 at this point. And we make all our banjos out of all native Appalachian hardwoods. We don't use any ebony, no rosewood, nothing.
Oh, well, that makes you kind of unique, doesn't it?
Yeah. And then all of our parts we manufacture or have manufactured for us. It's all made. All of the metal bits, metal parts are made in the USA. And we sell these parts to a lot of other banjo builders.
Okay.
We have a company called Balsam Banjo Works that sells these parts to other builders.
Okay, so you can be a manufacturer and a wholesaler of parts to other wholesalers of parts as well as to other builders, because you're using the native hardwoods, right?
Yeah. And we sell rim. We sell a lot of banjo rims too.
Yeah. So if somebody went to your shop, would there be a lot of sawdust and glue? I mean, do you do that part? Or
we try to keep it pretty clean. I'm on my guys a lot too.
No, I mean,
it's more like we're more set up like a factory. Like,
yeah.
Like a one-person shop.
Yeah.
So we have our kind of routines that we do to keep the shop clean.
So do you have one person who just does one thing, or do you just take turns doing one thing?
No, that would get kind of mundane and boring.
Yeah.
I like to switch it up with my guys. I mean, there's definitely several tops that they like jump in between. But I do have a guy that just like makes banjo rooms.
So you've been doing it, what, about 4 or 5 years? Or?
No, I've been building over 10 years, like 11. See, I built my first banjo in 2005.
Wow.
And I started Pisgah Banjos in 2012.
So what inspired you to build banjos? No, I mean, there are a lot of ways. I mean, you know.
I couldn't afford a banjo.
That's a good reason.
And I just built my first one. I was looking like on elderly instruments and saw that banjo builders were like making a living doing this.
Oh,
Bart Ryder and Chuck Lee.
Yeah, I've heard of Bart Ryder. He's in our area. Is he in North Carolina?
What's that?
I've met people at Bart Ryder Banjos.
Yeah.
Is he in this state? I forget.
He's in Michigan.
Oh, Michigan. Okay.
Yeah, and so he kind of took me under his wing a little bit and has helped me out.
Yeah.
After I made my first one, I just kept making them, and people kept buying them, so I still keep
them. There you go. So do you still have your first banjo, or?
No. That's my one regret. I didn't keep my first banjo.
Yeah, a lot of crafts people want. So they can say, oh, yeah.
I have the neck for it. I don't have the pot. I think I used the pot on a different banjo.
Oh, gotcha.
That's all.
Okay.
Old man fell out in the road. Yeah, when your time comes, you'll be booked and you gotta go. don't know what you'll be doing when that old reaper comes to call. Don't even know what you'll be doing when that old reaper comes to call. You look you right in the eye. So I hope you've had a nice night. Now that's all. Here he comes. I hear him walking down the street.
Do you learn by ear? Do you learn out of tablature books?
Just by ear.
Get my ability to learn by ear better, and
yeah.
Then someday I'll try to build
ear.
Repertoire of it.
Just by ear. So I go onto the banjo websites and whatnot, and I'm thinking, I'm going to find a lot of lady banjo players. And I go into the building, you know, building and restoration parts of those websites, and there's all these guys there going, don't bother. You know, I mean, it's unspoken, but there's this sense of, oh, you know. So it's really kind of startling. I'm pretty pleased to hear that you're doing something about women banjo players.
Well, you know what? That's interesting.
My fantasy is to quit my day job and be that. I restore old banjos.
Oh, well, tell me about that. Tell me how you got into restoring old banjos. I got into this.
How did I get into restoring old banjos? My dad could do anything with his hands. Absolutely anything. And I've done everything with my hands all my life.
So, okay, but what kind of stuff did he do? Did he work on cars? Did he build houses?
He worked on cars. He was a Depression baby, so if the air conditioner broke, he made the part. He worked on cars. He was a woodworker. My mother
Did he grow up on a farm?
He did. My dad grew up on a chicken farm.
That is where you did have to learn how to fix it.
Yep. So dad could do absolutely anything, and my dad was the one person who taught me that I could do absolutely anything. So they're in the retirement home now and so forth, and I ended up with all my dad's woodshop tools.
Wow.
So, you know, I had the belt sanders and the drill presses and all that stuff.
Okay, well, I'm interrupting you here.
Yeah, interrupt.
Is bad when you do this.
Interrupt.
Did your dad get arthritis or something? Because I knew somebody was an incredible woodworker. He still had his tools, but he could no longer do it.
He still does a lot, but he's nearly 90. So they have a fabulous wood shop at the place where he lives.
Okay.
So he just couldn't take all of his tools with
him. He just wanted a more leisurely lifestyle. Okay, I get
you.
Okay.
The aesthetic of the open back banjo is astounding. So I'm cheap. So I figured, okay, I'll buy these really old, beat-up, trashed instruments on eBay.
On eBay, okay.
And
you didn't, go into the local Goodwill?
Oh, no, I look there all the time, but I can be really picky on eBay.
See, people think rural Virginia, you go around there, just all these wonderful instruments.
You would think that, wouldn't you? But it's a wasteland. No.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
No, so I get all these trashed, fabulous old girls on eBay, and there's almost nothing left of them, and I restore them.
You're talking about banjos when you say old girls.
Yeah.
Do you always think of banjos as feminine?
I do. I do, except my main beater. And my main banjo is, his name is Mr. Patterson, because a Warren W. Patterson from Marshalltown, Iowa owned him and put his name, engraved his name in the armrest and on the inside of the banjo. So that's Mr. Patterson.
Okay, now I gotta stop you here, because I have a very good friend from Iowa, although he's lived in Colorado ever since college. But Iowa is a very big part of his life, and it's a whole definite way of life. And he builds banjos, repairs banjos, awesome stuff.
Wow.
So Iowa is a whole, and his dad was a little like your dad.
Yeah.
Like when he was still at the tail end of being a hippie, I guess you'd say.
This is my son Wes, who's...
Oh, Wes, pleased to meet you. We're talking about building banjos.
Oh, cool.
And his dad came to visit him and his mom when he was, you know, living in a sort of post-college neighborhood in, rental duplex with his girlfriend. His dad went around and fixed all the hinges on the door, fixed all the hinges on the cabinets of the door, you know, which you never do in rental property.
No.
Like, fix the screen.
No, that would be my dad.
Okay, so that's when you say Iowa.
Yeah.
Maybe my friend Bill out in Grand Junction knows this guy.
Well, no, you can talk about that too. Yeah. But
I mean, because that's truly, that's kind of where it comes from us, is anything we build is based on being, you know, restorers of vintage instruments.
Okay, and well, so, tell me about that.
Yeah, well, I mean, just the restoration process of all these, you know, instruments, usually ranging probably from, you know, within the last 100 years is the most common. We've done plenty of like Civil War era banjos, things like that.
Where do those come from? I mean, how does someone have one, and how does someone decide to bring it to you and all that kind of stuff?
Well, as far as getting it here, it's just, you know, we really just serve the community, and fortunately, being a player, you know, being an old-time player, I know the community.
Yeah.
And, you know, whether it's restoring an old instrument or building something for somebody,
yeah,
you know, we're serving them, and they're serving us, so really it's a word of mouth, you know, we don't advertise much.
Yeah. So are these...
Haven't had to.
I know some about this, but not as much as you do, but anyway, so like, is this somebody has their great-grandfather's banjo in an attic and they bring it to you, or is it somebody's gone out and bought one because they're
all
banjo
of the above, yeah, you? I mean, you might find it in a, you know, some, you know, a non-music related, you know, it could be in an antique store, and it's, you know,
yeah.
And you know, oftentimes they don't have much value other than to the player, and they can be, once they're put back together and set up properly, they can make great music.
Okay, so you're dealing with musicians. You're not dealing with somebody who's a collector.
All of the above.
It's not like a Strat.
Yeah, we work for collectors, people who don't play much but are obsessed with, you know, finding, like, there's a white lady.
Okay,
you
know, show that to us. I know something about this, but not
this
much. So why don't you explain it as
typical,
if I were a dummy? Okay, wait a minute. Let me get the. All right. Okay.
This is a Vega made white lady banjo. That refers to the type of tone ring. This would be mid-teens, so about 100, right at 100 years old.
Wow, really? Did Vega make the original white lady? Because white lady was like a brand name of a model, right?
Fairbanks.
Yeah, Fairbanks. Okay.
And this is another design. This is a Bacon. This is from the 20s.
I didn't know those kind of tone rings.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that went back to the 20s.
Yep.
Okay, let me zoom back here, because I got to get all this in. Okay, explain that tone ring then.
Well, this is the resonator. It's called the internal resonator.
Yeah, uh-huh.
So it's I guess you maybe kind of see it as a hybrid between an open back banjo and a banjo that has a separate resonator that it gets attached onto the back. So obviously this is permanent. It's not removable, but I think it emulates that tone a little bit, so it sounds sort of in between an open back and a resonator banjo.
I didn't realize that went back that far, because like you see these pictures of the guys up in Mount Airy, like Cal Creed and those people, and they're playing just bluegrass style resonator banjos.
Sure.
So So I thought the open back was more like a folk thing, just
sure.
You want something that looks correct or right. Something rather than...
Well, the first banjos were drums, like, I mean, other than, you know, coming from the gourds, but the first, you know, manufactured banjos were drums.
Yeah.
Oftentimes, they had a head on the back, just like a drum would.
What do you mean? They had a drum on both sides?
Correct.
Oh, and then just that, what do you call this thing here?
The dowel stick. Yep, dowel? That was one piece. Yeah, this is two pieces.
The dowel stick?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Originally, this would have been all one piece, right?
In the early often, design. Like on a gourd banjo, it certainly is one piece.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Okay. This is one of our banjos. We call it the Simmon Tree. Based on, we use persimmon. And, you know, they're common, you'll find lyrics in old-time songs referring to, you know, simmons.
Possum up a gum tree.
Possum up simmon tree.
Yeah.
So we use persimmon. Yeah. This is a botanical kind of sketch, you know, of a persimmon leaf.
Oh, let me get a shot of that.
Persimmon twig.
I used to find a lot of persimmon trees in Durham walking to work.
Yeah.
People tend to cut them down because they don't like the mess.
Sure. It's an extremely dense wood. And so we've found... we like using, you know, local substitutes for traditional woods. A lot of the woods that are used come from, you know, in stringed instruments come from Africa and Asia.
Meaning mahogany or what?
That'd be like traditionally like Honduran mahogany.
But
rosewoods, you know.
Yeah.
South America, India, Africa. So this is made of persimmon and holly. All the white colored pieces here are made of holly.
Wait a minute. Holly. So that is not plastic or mother of pearl. That's actually wood.
Mm-hmm.
Well, where do you get your woods? I mean, obviously you can't just go down and cut it down a tree because it has to be cured.
We have local sawyers that when they encounter a persimmon tree of enough sizable enough, they don't get real big often, but when they do, we can, we've got in contact with a few, and they look out for us, so they'll let us know if they've got...
You say local sawyers, are these people just clearing land, or are they...
Yeah, maybe someone's developing or just doing some, you know, some selective logging on their land or something like that.
Okay.
So,
And the word
yeah,
is...
They've got, yeah, and they have connections with all different types of artisans and
craftspeople,
builders.
I guess I never really thought of that. So people
might be on the list of a couple around the area that when they see something that they know we need, they'll give us a call.
So like people are like landscapers or something. Sure. Most of the ones that we're familiar with,
they're pretty small scale.
Yeah.
You know, something that can be milled on site, the portable sawmill, and then we can pick it up and stack it and start the hair drying process.
Yeah. Do you do that here on the premises?
Mm-hmm. We have in the crawl space. It's full of stacked persimmon. Yeah. Yeah.
I guess that's not very visual to crawl down and get a shot of it. No, like I said, I used walking around here, particularly in the 80s, I would see persimmon trees all over. And
Well, it's a beast. I mean, it's really dense material. It's a relative of ebony. And if the trees get big enough here, the center of the tree will actually get black. It's not a large section, so you couldn't get large ebony pieces, but it is a relative, and it's really dense.
How did you learn about that? I mean, you know,
just reading, you know, books on trees and casual study of botany. I didn't study botany in college or anything, but my business partner and I were both trained archaeologists.
Oh.
So we met doing archaeology and...
Like where?
We met in the Midwest doing that. We worked together a little bit in France. And and then he continued working in the field. I was already in the music field, and he was... he continued in that. You probably know... I mean, everything... It's a tough field because everything I learned has changed. You know, new things have been discovered. The books are completely rewritten, and it's a struggle because the people who published all this, you know, they're trying to hang on to.
I hear it's a very cutthroat field.
It is, and they're not willing to accept the information or the what is implied from a new site, and it's really hard to, you know, you've got to go forward, but, and it's also hard for someone who studied it and keeping up, because I don't keep up with the changes, and so my understanding of the way things were, you know, has changed in the last.
Okay, so tell me more about this banjo then, like you're trying to explain it to someone who might come in and say, I'm interested in a banjo.
Yeah, I mean, it's really designed for the, I guess what you might call a modern old-time musician.
Yeah,
You know, well, old-time has kind of morphed from different things, from old string band music to, you know, ballad singing, and, you know, it all that kind of gets roped in there, from however you want to define old-time. Certainly influences of African banjo traditions and British Isles, you know, reels and ballad singing and all that.
If
you ask, you know, an individual to define old time, you'll probably get slightly different answers every time. But
no, there's this funny cartoon that I saw on Google Images. It's these guys, I think they're modern guys, but they're dressed like it's 1920s or earlier. One guy's, you know, there's these, like, one guy said, well, what is old time music? Another guy says, what does he say? I have no idea. All I do is play it.
Yeah. I would agree with that. I mean, there's so many banjo techniques that I'm not I'm not the person to illustrate those. But one of the things we've designed, we've thought about in our design, because we use a persimmon, the density of the wood offers a certain clarity to the tone.
Oh, okay, okay.
The modern trend in old-time banjo has gone toward the deeper and kind of plunkier the tone, the better. And which I generally like, but it can get a little bit lost in the mix when you start to play with other people. I think it's really nice.
Deeper toward, you get more resonance in the lower lower pitch.
I think it's really good for just like
a less bright.
If you're doing like a traditional just fiddle and banjo.
Yeah.
Duo, I think that sounds good, or just accompanying voice, singing behind a banjo is great, but if you're playing in a mix, they just kind of get lost, and so what we're trying to do is create like a deep tone, but with a more clear attack, so the individual notes are maybe a little more articulate, and so using a denser material, the persimmon helps with that.
Oh, okay.
Custom line. This was a curly maple tuba fan.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
We use a lot of persimmon for the fingerboard.
Well, I know what persimmon is because, you know, I live in Durham and it grows wild. But so, how do you guys get persimmon?
I have a supplier.
Okay.
And then that's our kind of our signature inlays.
Oh, let me get a close up of that. Whoa, okay, does that represent something?
It was just a inlay design that we found out of I forget what book it was. It was like America's Instrument, I believe.
Oh, okay. I didn't know if it was one of those quilt patterns like flying geese.
Yeah, but I think the inlay we saw was in the Frelling Scoop in one of the pictures. I forget what banjo it was, but I liked it so much, I just started.
Yeah, it's totally cool. Well, what are the two woods in that?
Cherry and walnut.
Wow.
And I have those laser cut.
But you still have to do the inlays, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just amazed that people can do that. So I know what a tubophone rim is, but explain what it is, but how it's different, what it is.
It's made out of a square tube.
Uh-huh. Why don't you show it to us?
And then there's rolled brass ring on top of it. They were really popular.
Yeah, I think they were popular when banjos played with orchestras. And they were called tuba phones because they would use loud as a tuba. Or if they couldn't afford a tuba to play John Philip Sousa, Oompa Oompa, the banjo would do that. At least that's what I think. Yeah, okay.
Or it could be, I've thought about this, it could be because it's a square tube.
Oh, you think so? Oh,
I don't know. That was another thing I was thinking. I was like, okay. Oh, a tuba.
Okay. So what are the other woods in there?
Walnut and curly maples.
Yeah. Okay. And what is the neck?
The neck is curly maple.
Oh, that's curly maple.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess I'm used to seeing curly maple stained a little darker.
Yeah. This is a blonde.
Yeah. And so what?
That's the persimmon.
Persimmon. Oh, is persimmon hard enough for a?
Oh yeah. Oh. It's in the ebony family.
Man, I never knew that. See, what we know.
White ebony.
What we know about persimmon is they're not ripe enough to eat till they're on the ground and they've got all this dirt on them, and then you can slip on them if they're on the sidewalk.
And then we do these metal clog rims.
Oh yeah.
There's a copper spun over rim.
Yeah, somebody was telling me earlier he saw that. Well, wait a minute. No, spend some more time on it. Yeah, sure. You know, we're just trying to.
This one has a Dobson tone ring.
And what is a Dobson tone ring?
It's another historical tone ring from the 1890s.
And what's its unique shape, I guess?
It's bell-shaped, so it gives that sustain and resonance.
Oh, okay. Can you demonstrate that? Wow.
And the cool thing about this is you can pop it out and put the head directly on the rim and get it.
Oh, you can pop out the tone ring and then put the head. How do you do that? You just take off.
You have to take off the head. And it just like pops right off. This is a stainless steel one.
Okay. So. And what is the advantage of that? Just
different look. Yeah. It's a little bit more harder, a little bit more durable than the copper.
Yeah.
But.
My banjo is one of the old Bakelite banjos, but it's pretty weatherproof because it's plastic, you know, and so I don't have to baby it, you know. So, but it's not, it's not a vintage instrument, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, tell us more about your model banjos, if you don't mind.
We have a couple more. This is our woodchuck model.
Okay.
So it's a wood rim with just a simple rolled brass tone ring. It's made out of ash, completely out of ash.
Oh, now that's I've heard that name, but I wouldn't even know what an ash tree looks like. So what is the characteristic of ash wood?
It's kind of like oak, white oak.
Very dense.
Yeah, but kind of porous.
Oh.
I like it a lot. Bends really well, carves really well,
So you steam bend the wood for the rims?
Yeah.
Because I have seen rims where they just cut these trapezoidal blocks and glue them together and then machine them.
Yeah. And then this is a possum model. It has a persimmon tone ring. So it's going to be a little bit more plunky.
So you mean the tone ring itself is wood, and it's on top of another piece. The pot made out of?
Walnut.
Walnut and persimmon, and is this walnut?
Yeah, it's walnut.
Yeah, it's like it looks like you use your woods in the natural color instead of staining them. There's a lot of these woods when you see them in furniture, they're just stained. They're so much darker.
Yeah, we like the clear mostly. We do some staining, but we like a lot of clear.
Yeah. Well, that's really beautiful.
Thank you.
I might want to buy one someday, but what are their price range? I was here yesterday. They seem very reasonable, but they're not.
Yeah, so I discount these at the festivals. All these are $9.95 in the case.
Yeah.
They're normally, like the Possum models, like $12.95. Dobson models, $13.95. The Ramblers, the spun over rounds, are $13 or $14.95.
Yeah, well, for a handmade instrument, I mean, that's...
Yeah, it's totally affordable. That's part of our mission is to make them available and affordable.
What is the deal on this one there with a shorter neck? What is that about?
That's just an A scale. It's just a...
So you tune it to open A instead of open G.
Well, actually, you can tune it in G if you want.
Yeah. But the idea is you can stay in A without putting as much tension on the strings,
exactly.
Something like that. Yeah. Well, not everybody understands, if people aren't banjo players, they don't understand the banjo tuning. So you want to explain that or do you want me? I mean, there's more than one banjo tuning.
I'm kind of the worst person to ask.
Okay, there's A tuning, open A, which is the same as open G, but yeah. Two half steps up.
And like a lot of people capo too. I don't use a capo.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well,
I tune up.
We have a weekly old time jam, and if it's not in any other key, it's always going to be in D. And so that's a double D tuning, which I know is double C, but you know. So, do many people where you play in double C, double D tuning, or is it all A and G?
You know? Yeah. I usually, you know, if I go to a jam, I usually bring two banjos with me. I'll bring an A scale banjo, and I'll keep it in A and D, and then I'll have a 12-inch standard or short scale banjo and keep it in D or G.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. You know, in books and records, I've heard people playing in mountain modal, but I've never, and I sometimes do, but nobody ever does that in any of the jams. Do you ever do that?
Yeah, it's more like kind of like a solo thing.
Yeah, that's what I think, like Roscoe Holcomb and all those guys.
Where are you from?
Oh, I live in Durham.
Okay, Durham.
Durham's always had an old-time scene, and it's spilled over to Chapel, which is a college town, but...
Right.
The roots of the old time music scene there were the farmers and the factory workers, but you know, it spills over because music goes everywhere. And we have a weekly old time jam, you know, predominantly fiddle tunes. Some week they'll decide to play in C, in the key of C, which I guess is C tuning. The fiddlers usually decide. And so, all the C tunes have a real ragtime influence. They're very jazzy, you know. They're not like the older fiddle tunes. And
there
so
he
on,
is.
So
did you finally wake up?
It's too damn short. Take another solo.
How come you're not sitting here playing a Martin guitar to do that same music?
Well, you know, factory-built guitars just don't have the mojo. And it's also sort of about original music. You know, I wrote the song, and I just have this really strong feeling that I should build the instruments that I play my songs on.
That's pretty cool.
So I built this one. Okay. My grandma built her dulcimer.
Oh.
It's which I still have somewhere.
What part of the country was that? Your grandmother.
When she built the dulcimer, I'm not sure. Probably New York.
Oh, okay. Most people think of that as like Appalachian traditions.
Yeah, and I don't know the story of how she and her mother got to building a dulcimer, but they did.
Well, Gene Ritchie used to sell a dulcimer build-it-yourself kit, but that might have been... I don't know if that was that same era.
It might have been a kit. I'm not really sure. they cut some corners, like the tuners or screws. They just screwed in and then they had a hole drilled in them, put the wire through the screw. And it was set up for six strings, although...
Oh, six string dulcimer?
Yeah, it's never had more than four on it.
Wow.
Well, I've seen it. But they had six screws to put the strings on.
Wow, I'm having a hard time comprehending that. And so how would they...
You just add some bass strings.
And so they would tune it kind of the way you do it, an auto harp with a wrench? Something?
Well, they tune it with a screwdriver.
Screwdriver, oh, yeah. Okay.
But yeah, like you tune an auto harp. Yeah, it's the same kind of idea.
What's wrong with my film interviewing when I laugh?
Camera shakes. Yeah, well, that's the documentary style.
Yeah, okay. Well, give us the tour of your instrument here.
Okay, well, this is a gourd that I grew myself.
Oh, okay.
And cut in half, put a little pyrography on it.
Okay, if you go to the garden store, what kind of gourd seeds do you ask for?
Well, that's a good question. My preference is for birdhouse gourds, large birdhouse gourds.
Birdhouse gourds.
Yeah. This, This is the offspring of a gourd that I bought from a gourd farm and then replanted the seeds. And there's no telling what the father was. So the original was a big birdhouse gourd. These came out birdhouse with a twisted neck.
Yeah.
So I ended up cutting the neck off.
Like for Purple Martin.
The neck was sort of right here and I sliced it past that.
Yeah, okay.
Because the neck wasn't very useful. You don't know for sure what you're going to get if you don't aren't careful about pollinating the seeds. The neck is a piece of poplar. Fingerboard is a piece of red oak.
What did you do? Go to a lumber yard? Or just
get these just came from a lumber yard. This is my first ever scarf joint, which is the way you angle back the head, and I was experimenting with how to do that.
Is that the standard way
That's the standard way, and then they cover it with veneer so you can't see the cut.
Okay, I've always wondered whether that was one piece of wood.
Yeah, no, it's... They cut it here. This piece used to be up here. Yeah. They cut it here and flip it over and put it on the back.
Yeah. Okay.
And, except on ukuleles, which are a single chunk of wood. But
yeah, because they're small.
Because they're small. You can do it that way, but it wastes a lot of wood.
Yeah. Get how they do
like,
it.
Like in a conting, which is a conting, however that's pronounced, ancestor of the banjo.
Yeah.
The neck continues through here. And then the bridge has feet to go around the neck so it doesn't actually rest on the neck.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay, I should zoom in on that. So the bridge...
The bridge has these feet.
Essentially straddles the through piece.
Right, it straddles the through piece.
Which in a banjo... I heard somebody call that piece on a standard banjo the perch because it looks like a bird was, you know, that...
Oh. I always call it the carry-through.
The what?
Carry-through.
The carry-through. Okay.
It's a carry-through neck design.
Yeah, okay.
And then
the feet of the bridge.
And the feet of the bridge.
Directly on the skinhead. They're sort of straddling the...
Right, so there's no contact between the carry-through and the bridge.
Yeah.
And that's unlike a lot of the African lutes that... where the bridge actually vibrates the carry through and the carry through vibrates the skin. That's typical of the griot lutes.
Yeah.
That are actually half spike lutes. This is a full spike lute because the spike comes all the way through.
And what is half spike? What is that?
Half spike, the spike comes through to here and there's a sound hole.
Yeah.
And then the bridge is attached to the spike. And the bridge comes up through the sound hole. It doesn't actually touch the skin. The instruments that people sometimes claim are ancestors of the banjo are largely built that way, the griot lutes.
Okay.
And the bridge vibrates the carry through, which vibrates the skin that's pressed against it.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's a different mechanism for getting the skin vibrating.
And you get a more woody sound, less plunky sound. Or...
I'm not sure there's a difference in the sound, but okay. it's a different way of getting the sound.
Well, you know, living here in Durham, I've seen a lot of visiting African musicians
yeah.
play things that basically have some kind of gourd-like body and a long neck.
Yeah.
And sometimes the neck looks less like a fretboard and more like a broom handle
right,
or something
right.
like that. But yet these are sophisticated traditional instruments.
Yeah, so. Yeah.
But I forget the name. Is that an accounting? Or
the accounting has a cylindrical neck
that yeah, okay.
makes it easy to tie the strings onto it.
Oh.
The strings actually tie it on and then they just push it to
oh, okay.
And I sometimes make instruments that way with an inch or 7/8 inch down and then just tie the strings on.
Yeah.
And it's a perfectly workable way to make an instrument. It works better if some of your strings are drones.
Which
is what they basically do. The accounting is like that. And then the head of this is from a goat skin that I actually bought from a guy who ships them in from Africa and sells them. And it was remarkably cheap, and I thought I was saving a lot by buying a whole goat skin instead of buying a drum head.
Oh,
but,
do you literally mean a whole goat, the skin of a whole goat?
It was the skin of a whole goat, yeah.
Oh, okay.
I still have plenty of it left.
Yeah.
But shaving a goat skin convinced me that it makes a lot more sense to pay someone else to do that.
Well, that doesn't look like you did much shaving.
I did a lot of shaving. Most of the hair is gone here.
Oh, okay.
And it, this is about as well as I could do.
Yeah.
And I don't want to do it again.
It has this sort of cuddly
it's kind
Ewoks
of it's kind of
something.
Cool, but it's I think I'd get a little more volume if it were, first of all, lighter skin, thinner skin.
Yeah.
And you know, at the time I didn't know what I was really looking for in a banjo head.
Yeah.
So I think a thinner skin would have worked better. So I ended up with a kind of quiet instrument that's still pretty cool. It instrumentally does what I want it to do, but it's
how do you actually that. you I don't know if you call it curing it, but when you put the head on it, what, you soak it in water?
Yeah,
it's
not tanned, it's just dried.
Okay. And what is tanned? You treat it with some chemical?
You treat it with chemicals. Mm-hmm. And it's a longer lasting preservative.
Oh, okay.
Or a more aggressive preservative or something.
Yeah.
But it makes the
is that what they mean by tannic acid? Is that the same?
What's that?
Something called tannic acid. Is that what they
tannic acid is?
That's what they tan.
Is one of the things that's used
yeah.
in tanning, and
yeah.
that's found in both tea and oak.
Yeah.
So
you can use
tea bags or ground up oak to to create the liquid that you tan in. But
can you use acorns?
I don't know.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if tannic acid's in those or not. But for a banjo head, the skin is just dried. It's stretched out and dried.
Yeah.
And preferably you want it completely shaved.
Yeah.
And you want a fairly thin skin.
What did you shave it with?
Just a razor blade. To shave it, you wet it down and stretch it out on a board, and then you just take the razor blade and go like this, and it's
okay.
Very painstaking and very annoying.
Like a single-edge razor blade.
Well, it was a double-edge razor blade, so you're at risk of cutting yourself the whole time.
Okay.
It doesn't take...
But not one of those plastic handled ones.
No, it's a razor blade.
Okay.
And it you're at risk of cutting through the skin at every stroke, and at risk of cutting your fingers at every stroke. It's definitely something I would let someone else do instead.
Well, that's
but then to put it on, you soak it again,
mm-hmm.
and
You wet it, shave it, dry it, and then soak it again.
You don't have to dry it between shaving and putting it on, but assuming that you don't go right to putting it on,
you need to
have it thoroughly soaked when you put it on. Basically, you start with a thumbtack. These are just regular white thumbtacks. You although you could use a, you know, traditionally they'd use a little stake of wood and might drill a hole in the gourd to put it in, or they might just be able to push them in. I'm not sure. But a little piece of hardwood would do it. But you anchor it with something.
Yeah.
And then stretch it across to the opposite side and anchor it over there. And then stretch it over here and anchor it, and stretch it over here and anchor it. And before you do that, you put hide glue all around the outside.
Right. You don't put that on the back of the head, you put that on the
gourd. Both up here and down here where the tacks are gonna go. And with it wet, stretch it on as tight as you can. And put the tacks in to hold it in place.
So the hide glue is a standard thing that leather workers have. And
It's a standard glue for making guitars.
Oh, okay.
You can actually get it, you know, the traditional kind comes as a powder, and you have to heat it up and mix it with water and keep it at just the right temperature while you're using it, and it hardens up pretty quickly. You can actually buy some that just comes in a bottle, like white glue, and at reasonable room temperatures, at very cold temperatures, it hardens up. It's useless, but at reasonable room temperatures, it's liquid.
Okay, gotcha.
And you just put that on, stretch the head over it wet, and then the tacks hold the head in place and tight until the head dries a little bit, because it has to dry a little bit before the glue will hold it.
Yeah.
And the glue has to dry before it'll hold it.
Yeah.
If you do it right, you get a nice tight skin when the skin dries up.
Yeah.
And I got a little bit of a tight skin, but it's not as tight as I would have liked. This was my first attempt doing this.
It could be. It was the and here's a cool thing. My main banjo is, well, it's a Ramsey Vega, but the Vega pot is from 1921, the year my dad was born. And my favorite restored banjo, and it wasn't planned, was from the year that his dad was born. And the other banjo that I play most often is the year my son was born.
I've got a friend who's on, back in the 80s, he wrote a book of banjo tablatures, and he's on, I guess, YouTube, among other places, as Rocket Science Banjo.
Mm.
You know him, that's Tony Spadaro.
Tony, yeah. I don't know him, but I've talked to him a lot, and
Really? Like
yeah.
how?
Well, I mean, like,
through,
he's an incredibly talented human being. Holy cow.
Anyway, see, I keep digressing when you're the one who's in the movie, so tell me more. Okay. So we're talking about the gender of banjos.
I tend to think of them as female. I really do. Except Mr. Patterson, as I said.
Okay, but there has to be a beginning moment, a beginning narration, like a beginning scene, because your dad was not a banjo player, right?
Nope, Dad wasn't a banjo player.
There had to be one day, like if this was a drama where
there was that one day.
Woman encounters banjo.
Woman encounters banjo. Let's see. Woman was highly classically trained flutist growing up.
Okay, they never said flautist, right?
No, I never played a flute.
Okay, always order where they're told.
So, yeah. So, woman was highly trained classical musician.
Okay.
And I got married the first time when I was 21, And what I wanted for a wedding present was the most beautiful resonator banjo known to man.
Because, okay, what? I'm older than you. Tell me what year, or you don't have to tell me what year, but people wanted resonator banjos. There didn't used to be the divide between open back and resonators.
Right, right. But who knew about open back? I only discovered open back a couple of years ago.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah. And that was the defining moment, because the
because in a lot of folkways records they would show these old guys with resonator banjos.
Yeah, this beautiful banjo appeared. It came and went out of my life. I spent, oh my gosh, the next 10 or 15 years in a competitive pipe band, bagpipes.
Playing bagpipes.
Yeah.
Because bagpipes are pipes and pipes are kind of like flutes.
No, because I just love the way they sound. It's aggressive and huge and fabulous, and they're really hard to play. Truly.
Okay, I gotta stop you again. What does perfect pitch mean?
Do you perfect know that pitch joke? Is tossing either a banjo or a bagpipe and actually hitting the dumpster.
Okay, the version I heard is you toss the banjo into the dumpster and it lands,
and
on,
it lands on a bagpipe.
Or an accordion. Or the guy leaves his, the guy gets the banjo of his dream. He goes to visit a friend, he forgets to lock his car. His friend says, you left your car unlocked, oh shit. And he goes out to his car, and what does he find? You know that joke?
No.
Somebody stuck two more banjos in
there. Oh, yeah.
Okay, I'm stuck.
No, it's true.
So, okay, tell me more about that first banjo.
There's not much to tell. Kind of the point is that it came and went. I think I had to sell it to pay the rent, and I never really did learn to play it, but I...
So you found it where? At a local music store when you
were... Oh, no, it was my wedding present for my first husband.
Oh.
Yeah. So, you know, the first
husbands
husband,
give wedding presents?
The first, well, yeah, it was a gift.
Was it wasn't an engagement
it was a
present?
Gift. No, it was a wedding present.
So you got a bunch of toasters and he gave you a banjo.
The only thing worth having.
Of course, more than having him.
He
right?
left and then I had to pay the rent and the banjo left. It was no big deal.
Oh, okay, because you hadn't, do you remember what brand it was? Or what?
No, and I'm dying to know. It had a huge... mother of pearl butterfly on the back of it, and I don't know what it was.
You know, Tony Spadaro calls that mother of toilet seat.
Yeah, no, this was gorgeous. I don't know what it was.
So it might have been a vintage.
Nope, it was brand new. But it came and went.
Oh, okay.
And I've played guitar all my life. I've played hammer dulcimer, played I don't know what all. Then my son came along.
Yeah, okay.
And Wes is an awesome flat picker.
Oh,
and
what age did he get into that?
I guess I bought him a guitar on his 13th birthday, I mean Christmas. He was 13, and it was one of those afterthought Christmas presents where I don't know if
say,
I have
Mom,
enough.
Mom, you gotta give me a
no,
guitar.
I don't know if I have enough stuff to give him, so I ran down the street to, you know, the local shop and bought him a guitar.
Oh, what town were you in?
Richmond.
Richmond, okay.
And
you said run down the street.
Yeah. Okay. And it was a horrible, horrible old guitar, and so I got him better ones, and he kept getting a lot better and a lot better.
It was horrible because of the action or the tone?
Oh, it was just a piece of junk. It was just a piece of junk. Well, I knew.
First, I started with $20 guitars.
Yeah, well, I knew it was a piece of junk.
Plywood guitars, yeah, where they were painted instead of finished.
Yep. So he started getting better and better, and all these years since he was born, I hadn't been making music. And
yeah, that's an old story.
Yeah. So he said, you know, you really ought to start playing again.
Oh, he said that to you.
Yeah.
Because
he's
was
the dude. Yeah.
By then he was.
By now he's 14, 15, 16. Yeah. And
what was he into then?
Blues, bluegrass, folk. Towns Van Zandt. He was already writing songs.
So
he's
he didn't
a
go
bit
through,
of a prodigy.
He didn't go through the Metallica phase?
No, he's got a Strat and he plays awesome blues and awesome electric stuff, but it's not that sort of teenager wannabe stuff. Never did.
Okay, I gotta interrupt you.
Yeah, go ahead.
So were you a single mom during this period?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So he's writing music and making music, and we went out and got me a guitar, and I started playing along with him, but it wasn't really satisfying because he's just so good. that I didn't want to compete with that. So I learned to play really good backup, guitar backup for him. And I enjoy that. But it wasn't doing that making the music thing. So I'm thinking, you know, he's playing a lot of bluegrass. I'll try a banjo. So I bought kind of a cheap banjo. Then we called them resonators. Started learning Scrugg style. Said no, it's just ain't gonna cut it. I'm too obsessive compulsive. I would have practiced for like 1,000 hours a day to get the rolls right, and I wasn't enjoying it. So there I am with this resonator banjo practicing the rolls. And going, you know, I can do this because I've been playing music all my life. I've been practicing all my life. I can do this, but I'm just not getting that I'm making music feeling. And went online, discovered the Banjo Hangout online, and started listening to old-time banjo.
Okay, like listening to what, on MP3s or what? Listening to
Just recordings.
Okay, so this was before you went out and had got lots of CDs or anything like that.
Right.
Okay. Actually, maybe that's post-CD. Everything's post-CD now. Okay.
So I started listening to that, and it was like, oh, I'm home. I'm absolutely home.
Revelation.
Yep, that was the moment. That was the moment.
The first clawhammer stuff I heard on Folkways Records in college, I said, oh, well, this is the real stuff it's based on, you know, and the phrasing kind of reminded me of the nuances of the way some of my older relatives talked, you know. So, oh, okay, I get it, you know.
Yep. So,
are there any particular tunes, any special tunes from that era, like a particular tune that meant something special when you started hearing the clawhammer?
I love anything modal. I was listening to all the old,
like the cuckoo
Hammonds kind of music and.
Oh, the Hammonds family, South Carolina, right?
West Virginia.
West Virginia. Okay, yeah. Confusing two different records. Yeah.
Yeah, so that kind of stuff I just love. So, so now Wes is busy playing sort of blues and folk and bluegrass, and I'm playing old time. So it's still kind of not working. So it started developing that now Wes and I are sort of feeding off each other and just, you know, playing whatever appears and loving that. So I'm not obsessed with building old-time repertoire right now. So here, it's funny, I'm just doing a lot of listening because I wish I had the 500-tune repertoire, and someday I will, I hope. I'm just doing a load of listening and loving it here.
Straight that with blues.
I could play it too.
Yeah. Something else.
Fortune's been quite hard. And you know, then other design elements are pretty typically found for like a modern old time banjo. The scoop here, this allows you to get your right hand further up again.
Okay, now explain to people don't know, why do you want the scoop there?
Well, it allows your right hand to play up here on the neck,
which lets gives you
a warmer sound. If you're back here, a bluegrass banjo is designed for bright cutting. Yeah. So you've got the focusing of the resonator on the back, and then picks on your fingers.
Yeah, right, exactly.
And then playing down by the bridge.
Yeah, exactly.
It'll give you a brighter, I'm in the wrong tuning, but.
Yeah. So no, I know what you mean.
The further you play up the neck, the softer the.
Yeah.
So this allows to get the right hand further up and gives a deeper tone.
Yeah, okay.
Some other design things. We've shortened the scale on ours. So the scale length, we offer a couple, 24.9 and 25.4 it's inches. It allows you to tune, like right now this is tuned to A.
Right. Uh-huh.
So traditionally a banjo, like when it was kind of the standards were first set, this is called the nut. The nut would have been sitting about right back here.
Yeah, yeah, and you'd be tuned to G.
Or C,
and a lot of people just capo to get to A.
Yep. And this so allows you to, this is actually, I would consider this an A flat banjo, so that you can tune it to G or to A,
okay.
D or C equally, you know.
Uh-huh.
So you can go either way without having to use a capo. When you use the capo, you can kind of lose a little tone.
Yeah,
the attack isn't as strong. You have to back off a little bit, and or have your string set maybe uncomfortably high. So it's just kind of designed for common key. Maybe the what I would consider the more modern old time players. These also do really good. I'm frailing or playing clawhammer.
Exactly.
There's a lot of. I would consider more traditional, old-time players who are maybe a little more studied or, play two-finger styles.
Can you mention any names?
I can't play any Charlie Poole stuff.
Okay, Charlie Poole. He was three-finger, I think,
And I'm thinking in the two-finger of more like a local guy, A.C. Overton, I was able to... I was fortunate to work on one of his banjos, Noel Gibson that he played, and he was just a great musician.
I've seen some people playing that style because I've been going to the festivals at least since the 80s and a little bit since the late 60s.
But the a lot of those guys were looking for a more cutting. Bright banjo. And so this, that's really kind of where this comes from. It sounds good played that way with picks. It's got that clarity of cut. It might be just a little deeper, but it's not as deep and muddy as someone who just wants to maybe just play more I don't know how to describe it, but what I would kind of consider new old time, like.
Well, it seems like now old time means the Surrey County Mount Airy round peak style, and as David Holt said on one of his programs, that that Surrey County is does not have a large population,
but right.
People all over the world when they play old time music, they're attempting the
influence outweighs the numbers. and it just became popular, and so there are so many variations. Like the old time music from like further south, like more in the deep south. It's some great music, and around here, it's a pretty small percentage of the community that are into it and that know it. I'm more of a fan of it. I can play a few tunes, but
you're better than I am, but that's how I describe myself.
But these people, oftentimes you focus on a region, maybe you're really into Mississippi tunes or some people around here. I think of Wayne Martin in particular, he's from Georgia, but he's extremely well studied, and he can play, his style is, he can kind of play everything, but he focuses on the tunes from that area, which are just... It's just a different sound. There's more blues and I don't know.
Now did you say this is Mississippi or what?
That would be true of Mississippi, but I'm thinking of Georgia.
Georgia, yeah, yeah.
Regions that that aren't far.
Well,
that far
is you know, I've been working on a thing, a fiddle workshop I recorded, James Leva, you know him?
Sure.
And so he talks about a lot of people. So, you know, but you listen to like the early Georgia fiddle bands, and mm-hmm. that's kind of really different. Like, I used to have a record called Hell Broke Loose in Georgia.
Right there.
Oh, there it is. And that's not just Ged Tanner. It's
right.
Yeah, I mean, it was all those guys.
Yeah.
And
yeah, that's a great record.
I was talking about how those guys were discovered at the beginning of the recording industry. You know, the whole thing about fiddling John Carson. Mm-hmm. His first record sold a million.
Yeah.
I gotta laugh. I'm sorry to gather shit. A million copies.
Yeah.
When there were only like 110 million people in America.
Right.
And he won fourth prize at the very first Georgia Fiddlers Convention in some like 19 something or early.
Mm-hmm.
So. But then, so those guys became the first country music stars.
Sure.
And they were playing real old-time music. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, then it went more in the direction of Jimmy Rogers, Carter Finley,
right.
which were songs and blues and
yep.
stuff. And
yeah, I think at that point, it was hard to define, like, I mean, that was popular music. And obviously now, this is a far cry from popular music. But I think that was considered popular music. In its day.
Lord Lute with this one with a plastic head.
Meaning a standard commercial banjo head, when you say.
Well, not, it's just a piece of plastic.
Oh, wow.
Because the, The gourd I'm using for the new one is actually the mother of this gourd.
Uh-huh.
I used half of it for a wood-headed
yeah.
gourd lute.
Meaning one with instead of skin, it's the face is wood, like a guitar
wood, yeah.
or something.
Yeah. It's a five-string, sort of medieval lute kind of thing.
Okay, yeah.
And I picked the gourd because split in half down the middle, it looks a lot like a lute shape.
Yeah, the medieval lute.
Yeah.
Which.
And so I've got the other half of that still.
Yeah.
And that's what the new one's being built from.
Well, how are you going to get any tension on just a piece of plastic?
By heating the plastic. You glue it on place and then run the iron over it.
Wait a minute. Okay, so it's a kind of plastic that shrinks when you heat it, like
yeah,
they use for do-it-yourself storm windows where you run a clothes dryer,
yeah.
Hair dryer over them. And
yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I that shows what I know. I would think if you heated it, it would just get loose and stay,
be a
Salvador Dali thing.
Well, you could melt it. So the amount of heat has to be right, but
oh, okay.
But yeah, that's the idea: is you put it on as tight as you can with contact cement, and then after that dries, you apply heat to.
So, what do you use? A hair dryer or a heat gun? Or?
I'm probably going to use a hair dryer-like thing that my wife uses in her art. That blows very hot air.
Okay, because I know there are the heat guns, they're used by people removing linoleum or something.
Yeah. And she's got a heat gun, and I forget what it is she uses it for, but she's a pressed flower artist. And it's used in something she does.
I saw an exhibit of pressed flower art somewhere. I don't know if it was or was. I can't remember where I saw that. Well, one good point of all that is even though this might just seem to somebody like a weird hobby or something, that you're making these instruments in a modern technological civilization, first world country. But the people make them in third world countries, they're still, I mean, as you are discovering making, there's still a great deal of craftsmanship and technical expertise required. You know, you could, they're not really primitive in the way, you know, meaning just, you know, stupid or not well crafted. There's a great deal of knowledge and craftsmanship.
Right, right.
Okay, well, you talk about your mother, but I think we leaped over something, just your knowledge or scholarship or interest in traditional instruments coming out of Africa. I guess we should say you are Dr. Oak.
Yeah.
Oak Root.
I'm Dr. Oak Root. Yeah.
And you are well known on the Black Banjo listserv blog. And also, have a presence. You have your own website and CDs you've put together and stuff.
I've actually. It's not just African instruments, but you know, I've always been fascinated by instruments from all kinds of cultures. You know, one of the first things I built was an imitation of a Chinese lute. That I saw in a museum, also a banjo-ish kind of thing. It had a skin name.
China is supposed to be the other place where they had invented a banjo-like instrument.
I kind of think it started in the Middle East and spread both ways.
Oh.
Because the Chinese instruments. Lute-like instruments, not some of their, they have some zithers and things that are clearly of Chinese origin, but the lute-like Chinese and Japanese instruments look an awful lot like some of the Middle Eastern instruments, and then you have a lot of those same shapes showing up in Europe. And even in ancient Egypt, and then across Africa, and I kind of think those things probably came out of Sumer, which certainly had such lutes.
My knowledge of Middle Eastern archaeology, Sumer, ancient Sumeria.
Sumer is roughly where Iraq is now.
Okay, which has been called, is that where Mesopotamia?
Mesopotamia,
yeah. Okay,
yeah.
The birthplace of civilization, et cetera, et cetera.
And, you know, they were taken over by Semitic-speaking Akkadians and Babylonians.
Yeah, the Akkadians were basically from Turkey, what we call Turkey.
But spoke a Semitic language. Babylon is one of their cities. I think they're really the same people. They certainly seem to have had a lute. And we see lutes that look a lot like the half-spike lutes of Africa in ancient Egyptian depictions.
You're talking about the paintings of everyday life on the tomb walls, sort of stuff.
They seem to be two-string lutes. They're things that seem to be dangling from the end of the headstock that other people have interpreted as tuning pegs, but as I look at it, it kind of looks like a tassel tied onto the string that's tied around a cylindrical neck, which is very common that kind of tying the string on is very common in African instruments.
Oh yeah, the tassel at the end of the string, because the tassels are actually the result of strings being made from multiple strands, right?
Right, right. Yeah. It's probably not necessarily an intentional tassel, although it might be.
Yeah.
But the, you know, I look at those pictures from the Egyptian paintings and. I think that's a string tied onto a cylindrical neck.
So when you're talking about a cylindrical neck, the end of each string is essentially just a loop that goes around the cylindrical neck, and they tune it by just shoving the loop.
Yeah,
okay.
And That's a really common tuning method with African lutes. Another one is the strip of leather is tied around and the string's tied to the strip of leather. Then you shove the strip of leather.
And the strip of leather might be more non-skid than the string.
Yeah, it definitely is. It's definitely easier to get that to move and to stay than doing it with just the string. I've built instruments both ways, and the leather has some issues with acting as a blockage for strings that are tied further up the neck than it is. But it definitely is easier to tune the instrument when it's done that way. And when I've built instruments that way, I usually tie a piece of leather around the neck under the strings, and then another one around the neck over the strings above that, loosely, and then have all the strings tuned further up. And that way I have essentially a nut. Don't know that any actual African instruments do that. I haven't looked at them that closely.
For those of us who don't play fretted instruments, the nut means not something that grows on a tree. But
right, the nut is
upper,
this piece right here, the strings.
The upper terminus of the strings on the neck.
That's a good word, upper terminus.
Although somebody could say, well, it's not really the terminus because it goes all the way up to the tuning
fan. It's the upper terminus of the vibrating portion of the string.
Yes. Well put. I always figure there's a semantic problem when you say tuners. Do you mean the tuning pegs, or do you mean an electronic tuner?
Right, right.
Or do you mean the musician who's tuning?
Yes, all those meanings apply.
I'm shaking the camera again. Okay, quick aside. I went to some talk on history of banjo that was in the rare book room of Perkins Library a year or two ago.
Mm-hmm.
And some guy had gone to some convention, and somebody had come up with the original ancestor of the banjo. And they showed it, and it really was. It wasn't an accordion or anything. It was an actual banjo, but it did have a cylindrical neck.
Mm-hmm.
And the term banjar originally meant the type of bamboo they used for the neck. And so they finally did discover the original ancestor of the banjo. And if I'm not, I may be confused, but it seemed like I heard at that or some other talk that it's tuned to the pentatonic blues scale, but as it turns out, all American rock and roll and blues is based on, so, you know, but maybe I heard Scott Ainsley say that part, you know.
Yeah, I don't know if that's true. The accounting has a really strange tuning, I think.
Yeah.
Well,
they were saying the banjar, not the accounting.
Right.
The accounting has quite a few strings, doesn't it?
No, it's just three.
Oh, okay.
And I think it's tuned like that. These two are a drone.
Yeah.
And then and of course, they aren't arranged like this. They're arranged in the other order.
Yeah, sure.
These two are function as a drone. And then this one, which is a minor seventh, is then used to play melodies. So your tonic note would be up the equivalent of two frets, although it's not a fret. There are no frets on the accounting, but...
So the minor seventh is the flatted seventh of the blues scale.
Flatted seventh.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
I think that was what came out of the discussion on the Black Banjo group about how it was tuned. It wasn't really clear what that seventh was.
Meaning
The fellow I was discussing it with, who is an accounting player, traditional accounting player in Africa. What is his name? Daniel Jada, is that right?
There have been a couple of guys who've come and given concerts at Duke or at Hayti Heritage Center in the last 10 years.
I think that's who it was. He was at the Black Banjo Gathering. He discussed how he tuned his and how his father tuned his, and they were basically a step apart. But if you assume that all the notes he was talking about are natural notes, that is white keys on the piano, then one of them had a major seventh and the other one had a flat seventh.
Meaning the difference between his tuning and his dad's tuning?
Yeah. And I don't know if he intended that or if he wasn't thinking about that at all, and the actual seventh is something in between, or he just doesn't think it's important to consider what it is. I don't know.
I can imagine their perspective, the African musician's perspective on the way Westerners want to look at what they're doing.
I think something that was important to me just wasn't important enough to him for him to even understand my question. And I think they probably use a 7-note scale that that doesn't have any accidentals and is not really exactly, doesn't exactly fit on our 7-note scale at all. Most likely their small intervals are bigger than ours and their big intervals are smaller.
We're primarily, like I said before, we're primarily coming to this through from our experiences as restorers of vintage instruments, which is primarily what's in the shop. We have, some things we've done, like with our design, you see these common problems, and so we've sort of tried to engineer the problems away, out-engineer these issues that we keep seeing over and over. You get a lot of broken headstocks on instruments. It's a really common problem.
Caused by?
A variety of things. Oftentimes, if it has an adjustable truss rod, the access is up here, and it causes a route to be here right at the weakest part of the neck. And so you've got very little wood, to support the neck. Yeah. So, that's one thing you get rid of. And you can decrease the headstock angle slightly, and you have less grain called run out, where the fibers in the wood are getting cut off.
Now this is all one piece, right?
That's correct. So the steeper the headstock angle, basically the weaker.
Oh the yeah, yeah, angle. Yeah. I can see because the grain is not being followed if it's all one piece.
Exactly. We made another set of this basically with the same materials, persimmon. Where we used a slotted headstock, like you'd see on a classical guitar.
I've seen those in some of those vintage photos.
Yeah.
Of banjos like that.
I think there's some on our website that we've done.
Yeah.
And with doing that, this could be considered a break angle. So the angle which the string falls over the nut, you can keep the same angle, while virtually having no angle to the headstock itself. So the string has the same angle, but the headstock is almost straight. I think we used a 5-degree angle on those.
So that's the advantage of that kind of headstock.
So extremely strong. Yeah, it can fall over and you know be against a wall and
like campground in the middle of the night
exactly.
In the dark.
And yeah. So and those are the things we were thinking about. Yeah, and using a finish that can be repaired easily if it gets too wet or it gets something spilled on it.
Okay, explain that because there's lots of ways to finish wood.
Different finishes are some aren't as repairable without noticing. So we use an oil. We use this. It's like a gunstock oil finish.
Which is what, like tongue oil, or what do you mean? What's the name of the oil?
Well, it's called True Oil. It's the
okay.
Proprietary mix.
Yeah.
But it's easy to follow up if something should happen to it.
Yeah. Okay.
Where other things, there's going to be evidence that you repair.
Yeah, you can see. Some instruments, just water damage will make it look crappy. And can that ever be?
You want to see some of these?
Yeah, but can you show me real quick, so what did you do with the truss rod? Or do you have a truss rod?
This is a fixed truss rod. So, I restore a lot of old Martin guitars.
Yeah,
and,
uh-huh.
Martin only in the last 30 years has had an adjustable truss rod
in
guitars.
Yeah.
For years they had a fixed rod.
And Martins weren't known for great action down by the truss.
But that wasn't because the neck was bowing. It was more because they needed neck resets, but not because the neck warps. It's more the body of the instrument that warps and allows the neck angle to go bad.
Oh, I thought there was somebody told me the volume you get out of an acoustic instrument depends on how acute that angle is at the bridge or something.
To an extent. Yeah. There's definitely a point of diminishing returns.
So I thought Martin made them that way just so they'd be loud because they didn't do a lot of up and down the neck back originally.
No, they didn't make them that way on purpose. I mean, they moved, okay. They move all the time, and that's what, that's what doing a neck.
Is that when they had scallop bracing? Or they...
Well, that's a different issue. You can come back here.
Yeah, okay.
So, I mean, staying on that topic, these are, Martin guitars with the necks being reset for that reason.
So how many years have to go by before they need that?
I think on average about 25 years.
Yeah.
You might get, these are all on their first one. This one probably needed it 40 years ago.
Yeah. What is the vintage of that one or the model?
Everybody this is 20s. These are all more modern guitars.
Yeah.
These two are from the 80s, late 80s.
Yeah.
And typically the neck resets I'm doing are 40s, 50s, 60s.
70s. Okay.
You're on number 2.
I have friends out west who build instruments, but I've never talked to them at this technical level.
Yeah.
They're into fine woods and stuff like that.
And these are persimmon rims. This one's actually maple.
How many piece? Is this one piece of wood?
No, these are. This is a bird's mouth joint here.
Oh, let me get a shot of that. It'll show. Okay.
So these are. This is an 8-piece.
Okay. Wait.
Maybe this one.
Oh yeah. Okay. Right. Wait. Right, put your finger. Yeah.
There's another one that's pretty evident here.
Hold on, I'm doing a shitty job of aiming. Put your finger back. There we go. Okay. Yeah, bird's mouth joint. Yeah. Okay.
And to our knowledge, no one's ever done this before on a banjo rim.
Oh, really?
So
how did you learn about this? Because what I've seen are blocks of wood.
Yeah, this is a block rim here. So we build them different ways.
Okay.
I'm not sure we're set on a certain design. We just thought that this could be, interesting way of doing it. Strong, a little bit more.
So is this any steam bending here or what?
No, these are all cut out.
Carved in that radius.
And we use a router bit to cut the bird's mouth joint. And so these start as square blocks.
Uh-huh.
And then they get rough cut, and then, assembled and then final turning and
shaping. Okay, okay.
But yeah, there's, you know, I'm not sure I have a favorite. We've gone to using maple, you know, I think the rim actually sounds better with maple, and the neck, the tone that the neck offers from the persimmon would probably be my favorite. The clarity, you still get all the clarity from having that persimmon neck, but it's not, the one with the ones we've done with the persimmon rims would be a little too bright for the style I play. And then some, you know, certainly.
Or the more plunky old time style.
Well, they would be better for like a two finger, like old time.
Oh,
like
okay. My style is just somebody who learned folk guitar and then transferred that to the banjo. It's not very authentic.
I mean,
but I grew up in the Midwest, and I don't know. It's just different than what I hear here, so I can't really sound as hard
what
as
part
I.
Of the Midwest?
Louisville, Kentucky, southern Midwest. Mm-hmm. Really, it's not the South. It's not the North. It's the southern Midwest.
Yeah, I like it there.
And just.
These are some...
You know, but people would sing all those same... You know, I grew up hearing this kind of music, but it wasn't round peak, you know.
Right. So these are neck blanks. These have already been cut out.
From persimmon.
Yeah, this is persimmon, holly, this is ebony. So this is, you know, we use a routing template, and we route the face.
Okay, now wait a minute. Is this a whole piece of holly underneath this, or just right along the edge?
Just bound on the edge.
Okay. Yep. Okay. Well, this is something I learned. I never thought you could just use wood as the binding, because it seems like traditionally they always used...
Well, it's better. It's actually better using wood.
Yeah, I would think.
There's less... The plastics often shrink and the solvents used in the production still... are sort of leaching out over time, and you get crumbling bindings, and this is much stronger. But it doesn't stay as white. We're not sure exactly how that holly will hold up.
Okay, but who does the inlays, the dots?
Oh, we just make those. I mean, those are just pearl. Those are mother of pearl.
Okay, real mother of pearl. That's,
and this kind of comes from, I can't remember from an old banjo from the teens that we saw this design on, and just liked it.
Yeah,
and we don't see it too much.
This sort of diamond shape. Yeah, that's so cool.
So this obviously doesn't have the overlay on here yet or here, and you know, haven't begun to shape the profile.
How long does it, from beginning to end, how long does it take to create one?
I don't think I can really answer that. We don't build enough to, and it's, you know, it's done in so many pieces.
Yeah.
It's a question that we want to have a better handle on, so that, you know. But primarily...
I keep laughing and jiggling the picture.
Yeah, we really are primarily restoring old instruments.
Yeah, that's where the trade
is. So when we build, it's when we have time. Someone sees... plays one of our banjos and wants one, and then they'll
like
place
a
an order.
Labor of,
and then so yeah. And then we're, you know, we're involved with that, but we're not really just cranking out banjo after banjo. There's no CNC cutting.
What is that?
CNC. God, was it computer numerical control? I think.
Oh.
Which is basically a cutting tool. So you know, you put your billet of wood into this machine. And, it cuts everything out.
Yeah, so that's like what, if you went to the Martin guitar workshop. Yeah.
You could cut out your neck blanks, your fingerboards, your inlays. Everything can be cut with CNC.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're building one at a time.
Whatever you want.
Okay, tell us what that tune was.
Kitchen Girl.
Kitchen Girl, okay. Not to be confused with Billy and the Low Gram. I don't know why I confuse those.
Kitchen Girl.
What do you like? Why that tune?
Why that tune? It's modal. Sort
you
of,
are
but
right.
You're playing it in G, you know. But
so are you in G modal tuning? Yeah.
No, I'm just in G.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
What is the fret placement on this?
This is Pythagorean. It's not.
Okay, so this is not what you'd find on a mountain dulcimer. It's not what you'd find on a guitar or banjo or standard
right,
banjo.
Right. Now a traditional mountain dulcimer actually uses just intonation. But
uses what?
Just intonation.
Chest.
Just.
Oh,
just. J-U-S-T. But most modern ones are built with 12 equal tone, 12 equal divisions of the octave. And most guitars are built with 12 equal divisions of the octave.
Yeah, which is why there are 12 frets between
to an octave,
the
yeah.
nut and the 12th fret.
Also known as the well-tempered scale that Bach celebrated in his well-tempered clavier, which tells you about when it came around. This is tuned so that the thing about the 12 equal scale is that every fifth is out of tune by a little bit, but it's tolerable.
Yeah,
it's very hard to hear the difference. The Pythagorean scale has 11 fifths that are absolutely perfectly in tune, and the 12th one is horrible.
Wait a minute, there's only one fifth per, if you want to do whatever, plunk around or whatever.
Let's see if I can find the bad fifth.
Okay, we're talking, we're talking about fifths and
what I mean is, you have a fifth here.
Yeah.
And you have a fifth from this note.
Yeah.
You have a fifth from this note. And a fifth from this note.
Yeah.
And that one's bad.
Oh,
it's out of tune.
Well, run through that again so I can hear it. Okay.
In a well-tempered scale, all the fifths are the same.
And they're all,
let's see, make sure I get this right. They're all slightly flat.
Yeah.
Do
you get that with a piano too as
yeah,
well?
Yeah, it's true on a piano too. It's,
yeah.
It's a feature, a perfect fifth is three halves the vibration rate of the note it's a fifth above. So it's a rational interval.
Okay, and a fifth would be like if you're playing in the key of C, then
you're playing C, the fifth would be G.
G, right, right.
So
also called the dominant, right?
It is the dominant.
Or when it's a chord, it's the dominant.
It is the dominant note and the dominant chord.
Yeah, okay.
So you can say the C is 2 and the G is 3 in terms of how fast they're vibrating.
Yeah.
That's a perfect fifth.
Yeah.
But the 12 divisions of the octave are the 12 divisions. The 12 divisions of the octave are done by the 12th root of 2, which is an irrational number.
The 12th root of 2.
The 12th root of 2. So if you multiply that number by itself, it's about 1.05 or somewhere around there.
If you multiply that number by itself 12 times, you get 2.
Multiply that by itself 12 times, you get 2.
Mind-boggling.
And that's because going up a scale is multiplicative. It's a logarithmic thing.
Yeah, that I know. Yeah.
So to go a 12th of the way to an octave, you have to go up by the 12th root of 2. So you can never make... You can never come up with an irrational number that equals a rational number. So the fifth can never be exactly in tune. So this has frets that are in that are rational, and the fifths are in tune, except that there's one of them that's not, because all of those little intonation errors, you also can't stack fifths and ever get back to the octave, because because there is no number which is a power of three that's also a power of two.
Well, that's another thing. I mean, to put it another way, there's a thing in music called the circle of fifths.
Right, right. And the circle of fifths in equal intonation in 12 steps does come around to the octave. It's a number of octaves.
Yeah.
But the circle of fifths in rational fifths never does, because the fifth is a power of three. Any stack of fifths is three to some power divided by two to some power.
Yeah.
Any stack of octaves is two to some power. And two to some power can never equal three to some power.
Yeah.
Except for zeroth power, where they both equal one.
Oh, yeah.
But that's a useless number for doing fifths and octaves.
Did the Greeks themselves understand logarithm or powers of numbers? I forget.
I don't think so. No, I think that's a much more recent invention.
Yeah, they understood that kind of stuff in terms of geometry, the Pythagorean thing, that apparently was kind of controversial.
Yeah. But the so at the end of the circle of fifths, if you want to come back to the octave, you have to really compromise that last fifth. And it ends up being way out of tune.
Yeah, okay, so to go around the circle of fifths, let's say you start C, G, D, A, E, B.
F sharp.
F sharp. And then you're back to.
Well, it goes on through the sharps. F sharp, C sharp. G sharp.
But they use some of that in a lot of ragtime, right?
It's a very common thing in jazz to walk down the circle of fifths.
Yeah, that's supposedly what the
you do like. Well, the sort of the most basic move in jazz is DGC, which is just
FDGC.
Just a D chord of some kind, a G chord, and then a C chord. Yeah. Well, you've just gone down a fifth each time.
Yeah. Somebody told me what is Thelonious Monk or John Coltrane, giant steps, if that's what that is.
Oh, yeah, it could be.
It's been so long since I've
But you can before. You can do that for a very long time.
Yeah.
You can run the whole circle of fifths if you want to.
Yeah.
And get something that sounds reasonable.
Yeah.
Because at every step you're doing a 5-1 resolution.
Yeah.
And then you just do another 5-1 resolution. Yeah. And you can keep doing it. Yeah. I think Autumn Leaves does that. That's the basic chord progression in Autumn Leaves.
Oh, okay.
And it's a really common chord progression in all kinds of jazz, including ragtime. It's sort of the basic underlying chord progression of all kinds of music, is to walk down the circle of fifths. Anytime you're changing keys, that's sort of the basic thing you do, and anything else you do is sort of a departure from that. Even country songs, Walk the Line does that every verse.
Yeah.
They change keys by going down a fifth. I think it's down a fifth.
That seemed to be something you hear in top 40 country music a lot back in the 70s or 80s, where where they, it seemed like they'd go to a higher, it sounded like higher.
The stereotypical country thing is to go up either half a step or a whole step.
Oh,
and to do it suddenly without preparation.
Yeah.
And it, and the sudden without, the and a whole step is, no, a half step is, a half step is the really common one in country music.
Wouldn't it depend on what key they're in?
It doesn't matter what key they're in. If you're in C, you just suddenly start playing in C sharp.
Oh, okay.
But the Beatles also did it in one song. And I Love Her does it. They step up a step going into the instrumental.
When they go to that thing?
Yeah, when they go to the instrumental. It's got a really pretty guitar instrumental. Yeah. It's just the vocal melody playing on guitar. But it's a step higher than the rest of the song.
Oh, okay.
So just without preparation, step up, go.
Yeah.
So that kind of thing, and that's probably a big influence for them that outside of their regular blues and folk influences was show tunes. And I bet that's a show tune thing.
Oh, I would think so.
But I
hear a lot of what I would call British Music Hall and some of their later stuff.
Yeah. But even, you know, like on their first album, they covered Till There Was You from Music Man.
That's right.
And I think there a lot of that in their music.
They did A Taste of Honey, but I'm not sure whether that was their own song, or you know, there's apparently more than one song called A Taste of Honey.
I wouldn't be surprised.
There's like the Herb Alpert one, and that doesn't seem to have anything.
Yeah.
And that's not what the Beatles did.
Right. Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if there are a lot of songs called that. It's a good song title.